Pihak Sekretariat mengucapkan ribuan terima kasih atas perhatian dan kesudian yang berbahagia Datuk, Datin, Profesor, Tuan dan juga Puan untuk menghadiri program kita pada hari ini, iaitu Research Webinar Series 2.0 Anjuran Pejabat Timbalan Naib Chancellor Penyelidikan dan Inovasi. Semoga segala apa yang dikongsikan oleh penceramah kita pada hari ini dapat kita gunakan semanfaatnya lah. Para peserta sekalian, tanpa membuang masa, majlis dengan segala hormatnya menjemput yang berbahagia Profesor Dr. Jamaliah Said untuk menyampaikan taklimat yang bertajuk Corporate Integrity System Malaysia, Bottom-Up Approach to Mitigate Corruption at Workplace. Majlis dengan segala hormatnya mempersilakan.
Okay, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Rabbi syrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I think untuk mendapat lebih keberkatan untuk sesi pagi ni, kita mulakan our session with bacaan surah Al-Fatihah. Al-Fatihah. Okay, first of all, I would like to say thank you to TNCPI office, Prof. Razif and the team, Nadia, for helping me to set this. And also to who else? For Dato' Asna, all the way. You datang join group ni. Because Dato' Asna is one of the founder. Prof. Norma also, I think, but Prof. Norma cannot be in all the time because she has other commitment at the same time. Apa lagi dalam ni, I think our friends from Integrity, but they have to leave this session soon because they are having talk apa program dekat Majlis Perbandaran Klang on Corporate Integrity System lah. I hope you have no problem with the slide. You can see, yeah. So the title that I'm going to share here today is Corporate Integrity System Malaysia, Bottom-Up Approach to Mitigate Corruption at Workplace. Okay. Yeah, you can see. Thank you. Okay, basically, I want to share a bit the journey of Corporate Integrity System because, of course, I have to acknowledge the founder here from my right-hand side. I would like to say, introduce here. Here is Dr. Nizam, one of the key player. He used to be in Integrity Malaysia. Now he left Pencin Awal. And here next to Dr. Nizam is actually Professor Datuk Dr. Ishak. Actually, kita apa sedekahkan Al-Fatihah kepada Datuk Profesor Ishak. He is the husband to Datuk Asna. Just now, before we start just now, I was talking to Datuk Asna and Datuk Ishak is actually her late husband. He was working very hard to make this corporate integrity system a success punya instrument lah. And I just realized this morning, CISM is celebrating our 10 years anniversary. We started in fact 2010. Now I realize, then nanti lepas habis session ni we celebrate our anniversary. So at that time we worked very hard with six roundtable group, which is Security Commission, TI, SPRM, SSM, and also Integrity. So the 16 ni datang dari ni, and also academic. We as academic, actually our job is to develop the instrument, and also industry player. Kalau tengok kat sini, from industry player also, they take part in developing, helping to set up the instrument. Okay, basically the discussion here, I just take a few photo of our roundtable discussion, continuous discussion from 2009, 2010 sampai lah 2012 where the instruments are actually ready to be used. And also I would like to share the instrument. The instrument is Corporate Integrity System. Actually, later on I will tell you the story how we get this. Basically, this instrument, they have 14 dimension. Okay, this Corporate Integrity System, we have first to make sure that any organization, remember, because Corporate Integrity System is not for individual, it's for organization. So organization, first they have to have a strong foundation. Apa foundation for Corporate Integrity System? There are four: vision, mission, misti mantap, leadership ethical mesti ada, ethic resources, legal compliant policies and rule. Those are foundation of a corporate integrity system. Okay, next, the culture, itu dah middle level. Kalau rumah, the foundation di bawah. Then ethical culture is the middle part, that is organizational culture, disciplinary and reward measures, corporate social responsibility, ethic communication, ethic training. That is the culture, the middle part. And the atas tu, the bumbung, eh, the roof tu, is ethical risk management. Under ethical risk management, kita ada ethical risk assessment, whistleblowing and investigation, conflict of interest, confidentiality and transparency, bribery and cooperation. Okay? So basically, these are the 14 dimension of corporate integrity system. Okay. Oh, before that, I would like to tell you that actually this is not the work of ARI alone, but it's a combination of ARI, and we work closely with corporate Integrity Malaysia, IIM, Institute Integrity Malaysia. Okay. So basically, if I convert the 14 dimension tadi into this diagram, the first part, the orange one, is actually the basic one. You have to have that very strong first before you have the culture, the green one, the culture, and the purple, the one in purple adalah dia punya roof, yang investigation tu, dia punya practices management. Then you look at this number, dia kata corporate integrity system ada 214 descriptors. Maknanya, for every dimension, vision and goals alone, we have like 18 descriptor to describe what is mission and goal. Leadership, we have another 18. Ethic culture, we have other 18 to 21. Legal compliance, those are the range of descriptors to describe each component of corporate integrity system. That's why at the end ada 214 descriptors. Banyak kan? So imagine if 214 descriptors, how long the client need to take to fill in this. Okay, it's quite long. Then I will share you some sample of our client when they run this instrument. Eh? So basically, Corporate Integrity System Malaysia, we have 3 years, foundation, culture, the practice. Okay. So, okay, this is actually the original source of Corporate Integrity System, Dubinsky. After this, I will acknowledge him. Next slide, I suppose. Where actually the unique about corporate integrity system ni, originally Dubinsky and Allen panggil dia global ethic and integrity benchmark. Ini asal usul dia, okay? Global ethic and integrity benchmark. When Dubinsky develop this instrument, dia actually is a consultant company in US. So what happened? They already investigate. They already have more than 2,000 companies in US at that time. That was in 2010. In 2010, dia dah tolong 2,000 companies. So from that, dia dah boleh nampak what is the situation is like. If 0%, ni 0%. What is the situation at zero if the company, if the organization or if client is not having ethic and integrity at all? Ni 0%. Maknanya, there is neither an organization structure focus on ethic and integrity. Tidak ada. The statement is negative. Okay? So, dia nampak out of that 2,000 company yang dia investigate, this is the situation. And at 25%, what is the situation like? Ethic function are performed as additional secondary duty by mid-level staff. Dia macam ada tapi part-time lah. Macam if we put it under kat UITM, zaman-zaman dulu, maybe many years back, we put this under internal audit, for example. So there is no actually one unit is taking care of integrity. But now in UITM alone, kita sudah ada integrity unit and separately not under internal audit, for example. Some companies, especially yang kecil, new, because of, I think, constraint of resources. So what happened, they just park the integrity unit under one of the less outstanding department. So macam tidak recognized, though that is at 25%. So what happened if company is having corporate integrity system at 50%? At 50% dah nampak mantap. When there is a senior level manager, sini, maybe a bit wordy. I'll just pick out some point. Don't worry, you don't have to read every line. At 50%, meaning the company already have a senior manager in charge of that ethic and integrity. The senior level ethic manager report directly to the top. Bukanlah report kepada head dia, nanti kena pula screen lah, apa bagai kan. So, dia nampak that we are actually serious about implementing ethic and integrity at workplace. So, 75% ni dah start. Yang senior executive, tadi kat sini junior, senior tapi level middle-middle. Yang at 75%, di mana Dubinsky realize that company yang 75% dia dah start yang high level officer yang letak di sini, dia bagi resources, dia bagi bilik satu level dengan CFO, satu level dengan COO. So at 100% pula macam mana? At 100% is when the company is actually being visited by local or international company to benchmark how actually they implement the corporate integrity system at their workplace. So the beauty about this instrument is we can actually see where is our client at. 0%, 25%, 50%, 75% and 100%. Okay, from this we can advise if we discover that at this point when we exercise this instrument at company A lah, for example, at the end of the day we notice that one of the dimension, just now the 14th dimension, one of the dimension is ethic resources. Ethic resources, they are at say 50%, katalah on at 50%. So our next step to advise the company is how to go about moving from 50% to 75%. So tak adalah kita advise if we discover their performance now is at 25%, we don't straight away advise them to go straight to 75%. It's not easy. So we go step by step. So this is the beauty about corporate integrity system, because the job is, or the mission is actually to help, to assist the companies how to move on from what they are now. First, we have to know what they are now, where they are now. Next step is to advise them where they should move forward. So, of course, I have to acknowledge Dubinsky and Alan for allowing us to use this instrument with modification. In fact, I think Pranoma, and when they, in 2009, I think when she went to UK, he met this guy who was like, sujud syukur lah kan, while looking for what is the best instrument to help companies in Malaysia to implement corporate integrity, suddenly someone from US have been doing this extensively and allow us to replicate the instrument. That is like kita orang apa ya, rezeki datang bergolek kan. So now I would like to special mention to Dubinsky and Alan for allowing Ari, IAM and our team to use this instrument to help companies in Malaysia. Basically, the corporate integrity system is able to assess and measure progress in workplace. What I say progress in workplace just now, because we know where are they now. So what is the next progress? If they are at 25%, our next target progress is 50%. If they are at 50%, our target for that dimension is move on to 75%. So we don't actually intend to compare between company A and company B, because each company is different in nature, okay, size. So they have to be what they are, where are they now, what is the next step. Okay, they reflect global best practice. Why? Because this instrument is actually developed by Dubinsky, telah diguna pakai in US for 2,000 companies at that point of time. Pada tahun 2010, I believe now it's like double the number or more than that. Okay, so you can see where is your company at as compared to global best practice. So, and when Dubinsky developed this, is actually they based on ethical business conduct. It can be used not only in US, now Malaysia is using it. We have done quite a lot of companies. That's why I mentioned just now, if our partner or clique or audience from Indonesia, if can interested in actually applying this into companies in Indonesia, especially your state-owned companies, we are ever willing to explain in detail how this actually instrument can be used to help them to further improve their corporate integrity and ethics. Okay, in Malaysia, it is in line with ABMS, Anti-Bribery Management System, where we have ISO 37001. You look at the checklist element. So the instrument by Dubinsky is in line with that, and also in line with the adequate procedure guideline section 17A, I think you, some of you all realize that on the 1st of June 2020, baru ni, last week, eh, dah baru 9 hari, Malaysia they enforce corporate liability, exception 17A, corporate liability for corruption, where company must actually make sure they have adequate procedure guideline against corruption. So if you look at the 14 dimension by Corporate Integrity System Malaysia, that is actually the guideline, the trust or adequate procedure outlined by the ministry. Ministry, they outline 5 trust, yeah, how to make sure top management is actually having adequate procedure. Number one is actually trust, T-R-U-S-T. T is top management support. Yeah. So in the instrument dalam 14 dimension tu, fully ask about that top management support. Next one, TRR, is actually risk assessment. Of course, in that instrument, you look at the last four, the blue one, the roof two, it is more risk assessment. And U, TRU, U stand for undertake control measures. Yeah, it's again in the instrument. Number four, S stand for systematic review and monitoring and enforcement. Okay. Then again, all the dimension of corporate integrity system ada issue element of review, monitoring and enforcement. Last but not least, training and communication. This one is a guideline by the ministry. Yeah? And training and communication memang ada dalam one of the element of corporate integrity system Malaysia. Okay, this is what I mentioned just now. Yeah? This the beauty of the instrument, they will actually guide our client on how to move forward. If they are at 0%, meaning ethics and integrity at workplace has begun. Maknanya no, oh sorry, no ethics and integrity, zero, tak ada apa-apa lah kan. So question we akan tanya is item related to at 0%, what happened. So certain, the next level is 25%. Complete 5% ni macam compliant mindset. Adalah macam kita ada apa, dulu-dulu lampu apa yang speed track tu, ETS, eh, ETS. Kan, kalau ada tu nanti kita slow. Ni macam tu lah ada. Ada orang, ramai orang tak ikut lah senang kata. Tiba depan ETS tu baru kita ikut the speed limit. The rest we follow our own limit lah kan. Itu 25%. 50% dah. Half of the staff dah ikut, half of the companies dah comply. 70% dah mantap lah. Okay, dia kata seeing ethic and integrity systematically, a robust approach, dah mantap. Yang 100% tu memang that is our target lah, which people come to our company, benchmark our company. Okay. Okay, these are, I propose dalam satu slide je, actually we have more. This is what some of our client yang kita dah pergi, MARA kita dah pergi. MARA ni problem sikit sebab dia banyak anak syarikat. So actually, Corporate Integrity System Malaysia, satu company, satu report. You cannot actually combine anak-anak sebab you want to improve. If you, maybe you have anak syarikat subsidiaries, you have 10 subsidiaries. If you want to investigate, you cannot lump the whole population. You must do by companies, so that you know what is the weaknesses or the strength of each companies. So TNB, I present to the board, to the top management. EPM also, I did present to the board and management. Siapa lagi? UDA, I went. UMW, our colleague from IIM pergi. Rizaidi, I think Rizaidi not able to join us today. He's presenting to Datuk Wanda Kelang sekarang ni on one of the corporate integrity juga. DuPont, this is the letter, DuPharma, I just present it this year, bulan 2. Okay. Malaysian Airport, we have done many years back, maybe 2017. KPJ itu around many years back. So CCM also I presented. So these are some of the company we have been helping lah. Okay, so this the next session I want to share you some finding that we get from other corporate integrity system, so you can see how actually this system work. Because I have here with me in the group kawan-kawan yang nak belajar how to actually guna, then easier lah, because we have a lot of client interested tapi tak ramai orang pandai guna instrument ni. then we have no problem to share and teach you how to use it. Ini sharing of some findings. So here is, I think if I not I can recall this kat sini masa UDA kalau tak salah lah. So I present the finding first to the group of CIO, Chief Integrity Officer and the team first. Before we present to the board, we normally present to the team, integrity team. So if they are not happy with something, we improve it, then only they set time for us to present to the management and the board. This one is actually one of the session where we share the, we explain to the client what is corporate integrity system. This is TNB CAO. After the presentation of TNB punya CISM finding, kita makan-makan. This is the company yang actually do the corporate integrity system. Okay, basically macam mana prosedurnya, kita start dengan client engagement. First, client engagement. Team Sabah boleh tengok macam mana we start, because we are getting quite a lot of project in Sabah. We get offered by a few GLC in Sabah to run this. So first, client engagement. I think we have done a few, right? First, we prepare working paper, very short. Working paper, tahulah practitioner ni, dia tak suka working paper panjang-panjang. About two pages. So, what is actually corporate integrity system? We explain them. Especially now with upper section 17A, corporate liability for corruption. Companies must be very careful. They have to prove that they have actually adequate measure program. So now I think the demand of corporate integrity system is more because of the section 17A. So after the first step we have done, Team Sabah, client engagement, the next step is going to be data collection. So of course before data collection, a lot of negotiation in term of tarikh, macam mana nak guna online ke nak guna hard copy, nak guna bahasa Melayu ke nak bahasa Inggeris. So a lot of variation depending on our client. Some client nak kata dua version pula. Top management guna English, lower management guna, lower employees guna bahasa, okay je lah. Client apa? Customer is always right eh. Okay. So kita ikut je. So after we have done that, normally I want the client to choose respondent mesti ramai, seramai yang mungkin. Number satu. Keduanya, it must comprise of various level of department. Daripada top, middle, lower, yang paling lower sekali. So, sebab we want representative from each, okay. Lepas tu, we want, next step is, after we get the data collection, of course, we filter normal lah. Kalau orang isi ni akan ada missing, akan ada bias, then we run reliability test semua to pastikan that data, the real one only we take. Then we develop the database, kita guna dashboard, Power BI, sebab Power BI ni lagi senang. Zaman-zaman dulu when we started maybe 2014, 2015, kita guna hard copy. The instrument is very thick and it takes about 45 minutes to answer. Imagine be board of director nak spend 45 minutes. But some company they are very serious. Bayangkan dia duduk kat board room tu panggil kita. Tak ada satu staff dia pun yang berani keluar, give up isi sebab board ni semua mengisi. So if the top management is serious about this, senang memang kerja kita. So after that, I think of late maybe 2018, we start actually converting the questionnaire yang instrument tu, hard copy into online, pakai handphone boleh. So kita guna dashboard, Power BI, where the finding is very real. Maksudnya one submit, we know dah 50 orang fit in the question, dah 100, dah 200 people or respondent isi. Then we can actually analyze it right away. So lepas tu kita present the finding to CIO. CIO stand for Chief Integrity Officer and dia punya department lah, team dia. Because we are not sure actually what kind of information they want. So after they agree, then only we present to the dashboard to the top management and board. And finally we prepare the final report and also dashboard and data semua kita serah balik kepada client. So these are the steps. Okay. So senang kata macam ni lah. When I present to the board, I use macam ni. Tak ada wordy, nothing. So based on Alan Dubinsky just now, kalau yang biru ni, This is your client. Kebetulan ni KPJ kot ada, tak terlupa nak padam, tak apalah ya. KPJ. So maknanya dia performance is above the benchmark. Benchmark yang merah ni, yang tak bagus ni. Edit 0% macam mana, kat sini 25%, ini 50%, ini 75%, ini 100%. So if your line is below the benchmark, maknanya this is the area of improvement that we can recommend to our client. So some client dia kata tak apalah, yang we are okay ni tutup mata. Once dia punya level tu lebih daripada benchmark, global benchmark, close eye. I want to know what is the gap between the benchmark, the best and ours, so that this is where I want to improve. So I will go on to item ni lah. Oh, contohnya item 18, dia score berapa? 25 for example. So what happened? So here we provide suggestion on what they should go about to improve the score later on. Maybe after 1 year kita boleh revisit, tengok ada improvement ke tidak. Okay, these are actually the latest finding I share. Now bila kita dah pakai dashboard, dia cantik dah sikit rupa dia. So here is the respondent. Basically the respondentnya ada 325. So this is one of the entah ya, cerita nanti kan bahaya pula ya. This is one of the okay company, the good company, multinational, bursa, listed in bursa. So imagine yang isi 325. So dia actually dia position ni pelik sikit, nama dia tak sama dengan normal position. So they call it red book manager. These are top management. Ada middle sampai ke bawah sekali. So they comprise of all the anak syarikat apa branch. Dia punya branch and also dia punya position and dia punya years of experience. Normally when I present, I will start with the overall finding. Oh, this is the overall finding. Tadi kan ada 14. Oh, this company I think kita buat 12 saja atas dasar masa tu yang dua lagi dia nak buat kemudian. So you tengok, if you look at the score ni, yang paling tinggi score is vision mission, 81%. 81% if you look at benchmark by Dubinsky tadi, maknanya dia dah establish lah. Yang kedua, dimension yang kedua, compliance. Ini actually dimension keempat, tapi dia score second highest. Compliance, policies and rule, 80%. 80% ni consider very good lah tadi kan. Ethic communication, dia score 78%. 78% ni not bad, okay. Kalau kita tengok Dubinsky punya tangga tadi, dah nak yang atas tadi ya. So measurement and research 75%, whistleblowing 74%. I consider this very good because kebanyakan company whistleblowing dia score dia 50%. So this company having 74% score for whistleblowing is actually I consider extremely good. Infrastructure, ethic resources tadi 75%. This is where actually we measure whether the company have corporate integrity officer or not. Dia ada office dia sendiri tak? Dia report to the board straight away or not? They have allocation in terms of duit, staff. This is here infrastructure where they score actually 74%. Leadership 73%, not bad. I just highlight here in this case yang score below 70 because our next target to make sure they got all this score for each dimension 75%. Okay, so but we highlight the yellow one ni, accountability, confidential advice and support, ethic training, markah dia all below 70%. And if you look at this, kalau kita tengok asal Dubinsky framework just now, these are actually five item yang last call ni, semuanya letaknya di bawah mana? Dekat culture tu tadi. Kan we have foundation, we have culture, we have management tadi, ethic risk management. Dekat tengah-tengah tu yang score tu yang tak okay. Okay, so this is where we need to improve, I mean we advise our client on to improve this dimension. Okay, so now based on that tadi, I show the overall finding so that because they are all busy people, they want to know so what. So straight away I show the final finding, then I move on. Out of that final finding, 9 dimension are doing okay. Okay meaning markah dia above 70%. I do not know whether this is the right figure or not, 70%. Maybe we can ask for 75% the next level, okay. Cantik juga 75%. maybe kita kata, oh, 80% is the best. Maknanya anything below 80%, we consider not good. Tapi in this case, we say that anything above 70%, we consider their strength. Okay, contohnya, vision, mission tadi, they score 81%. Tetapi kenapa tak 100% eh? Soalannya, the reason dia tak score 100% because some of the respondents say they disagree. Contohnya, item nombor 11. 31% of the respondent do not believe the organization and its employees have specified respective expectation in term of integrity and ethic. So 31% of dari berapa eh? Respondent dia 200 something. That is a big number, you know. About 60 orang. Tiga kali dulu. About 60-70 orang believe that dia tidak ada specific expectation in term of ethic and integrity. 18% do not believe all employees in the organization behave in a way that shows their commitment. Masih dia nampak ada lagi orang yang tidak berintegriti. 18% daripada 200 lebih. Ramai tu kan? 16% do not believe each organization integrity target is reasonable, clear, measurable, achievable. So the good part about this dashboard, we can actually zoom in tau. Siapa yang do not believe ni? Then we can help this group to understand. Sometimes when we present to the board marah, dia kata, ish, we have done this, we have this, we have that. Macam mana employees tak tahu? Oh, baru kita tengok balik, oh, employee ni datang dari branch. So, the message tak reach the branch. So, tengok markah communication pula. Memang betul lah lack of communication. So, then when we present to management normally, kan kadang-kadang kita kena argue lah because we are outsider, we do not know what is happening inside the companies. So they feel that the management feel they have done enough, but orang bawah-bawah do not feel the same thing. That's why I said that it's good this instrument. They ask individual employees yang paling bawah pun kita tanya because dia berlaku dekat bawah juga, bukannya integrity violation dia berlaku dekat mana-mana kan. Jadi semua orang tu mesti ada rasa tu, rasa untuk comply to ethic and integrity. So normally after each dimension, kita tunjuk dia what is their weaknesses or strength. So what is the recommendation? What they should do? Okay, for example, number satu, kita kata recommendation because it's this. So our recommendation is to continuously educate employees to instill trust. So educate tu boleh guna stiker. I think sometimes ni dia guna banner, dia guna banting, dia guna dalam lift tu ada stiker, ada pakai dekat baju tu. Badge. So there are many ways to educate. So this instrument cantik because it is very specific so that management knows what to do next. The good part is we are helping chief integrity officer and the team. What happen when they ask something from the top normally, tak ada top dia yang nak melayan kadang-kadang ataupun top is so busy with so many things. So tapi bila kita outsider, consultant yang present, baru dia kata, oh betul lah, chief integrity officer tidak ada position yang level tinggi, dia letak bawah-bawah. So masa tu lah baru they listen to outsider more than the complaint by chief integrity officer lah in a way. So for client normally we go item by item. Semua item tu yang ada 14, tapi sebenarnya 14 item is new. Before this cuma ada 12 item. So the finding that I share with you cuma ada 12 item. Okay. So the next client we are going to start using 14 item basically because the section 17A tu juga dengan their intention to apply ABMS, Anti Bribery Management System tu. So with 14 item ni memang match lah to comply to both. Satu, section 17A, adequate procedure dan juga application for ISO 37001. Okay, now I'm not going to go through item-item with you, tapi you dah boleh faham, one I explain satu dimension, it apply to all the 12 dimension or 14 dimension eh. We go item by item, we see what is actually the problem. Contohnya yang ni lah, ethic communication kan. 34% tinggi juga ni kan, 34% of respondent do not believe the organization publish annual report about its integrity program and distribute this report both inside and outside. Mungkin the company, they do have annual report tapi dia tidak disseminate the report. Okay. So what happened, what they need to do? So we put the recommendation on the right hand side. Okay, ni dimension number 7, measurement, research and assessment. So dia kata 32% of the respondent do not believe organisation regularly review ethic benchmark. Maknanya once you set 3-4 tahun lepas macam tu lah juga, nothing is actually updated. So 14% do not believe ethic and integrity are regularly incorporated into culture survey. Maknanya tak ada orang buat all the survey, semua nothing to do with ethic and integrity. Masing-masing cerita pasal strategy planning lah apalah, not on ethic and integrity. So what are they supposed to do? In fact, for this company, we set for them to establish ISO 37001 by December 2 tahun ni. Okay. So after ujung tahun ni, we can revisit this company whether they have done this or not. Okay, now I'm not going to go through. Ni satu lagi, dimension 11. Satu-satu kita pergi. The figure is alarming bila percentage tinggi, eh? Bila 52% of the respondent do not believe tu. Yang tu kita alarming. So kenapa jadi macam tu? Why half of the respondent do not believe that data is publicly disclosed and regularly basis describe the kind of matter that have been reported? Maknanya ada integriti senyap je, tak ada orang buat. Tapi kalau ikut Dubinsky, you have to share this because this is actually, we consider this as awareness campaign. So that the rest yang belum buat, tidak akan buat. Next item, infrastructure tadi. 36% of respondents do not believe adequate financial and other tangible resources are allocated annually to integrity unit. Maknanya the company is not serious that integrity unit tu berfungsi, dan ramai ni yang believe that the company is not actually serious enough to implement and integrity. So I leadership. Then next one is culture, 71%, and we move on to disciplinary and reward measures, 71% score. Okay, so basically, if the score is this much, so why the score is this much? That's why we put the comment there. On the right side, we tell the management on what they should do to further improve the score. So it is tadi jadi company klien yang ni, kita tengok the three dimension. The score is below 70%. So what is the dimension? Number satu, dimension accountability. The score is 69%. Kenapa rendah tu? Sebab item number 5 alone, 54% of respondents do not believe that task delegation procedure is adequate. Maknanya tinggi lah tu, something is not right. Sama ada the top management memang tidak bagi task delegation procedure ataupun bagi tapi tidak di communicate to the lower level management. 53% ya, item nombor 2 ya, 53% do not believe monitoring mechanism is performed on a regular basis. Ni mungkin dia punya monitoring tu berlaku 3-4 tahun sekali, it's not regular. So if 1% say this, maybe we can close our eyes. Tapi kalau 50% of the employees say that, you better trust your employees, okay? Tak mungkin sampai 53 orang nak sabotage the company, right? So that's why we can say it's bottom up from the employees to the top. Okay. So sometimes despite we feel that we have done a lot, if employees feel that it is not enough, we have to actually trust them also. So this is the way we present. We will show them where is the gap. The red one is the gap lah, yang mana the benchmark is higher than the company. So if they are, our advice is for the companies to reduce this gap so that they are reaching to score 90% or in fact 100%, where all the employees believe the company is serious about having ethic and integrity at their workplace. Number 8 pun score dia tak tinggi, 68%. Confidentiality, advice and support. And also again, kita tunjuklah satu-satu kat mana dia punya markah yang rendah and what they need to do to further improve this markah. Then item number 9, ethic training and education. 57% of respondents do not believe integrity training is adequate. Bayangkan dah kalau employees kata dia tidak ada enough training. So you have to trust your employees. Mungkin kalau 5 orang cakap, mungkin this respondent tak baca soalan kot. Oh, this respondent ni adalah, you can give excuse. Tapi kalau 57%, 57% of 230 tu, 150 orang lah lebih kurang, believe that they don't have enough training on adequate, they don't have adequate training on ethic integrity. So that we have to trust these people. And what to do? Of course, the recommendation, we ask them to do this. The one by one, the instrument is very, what you call it, is very user-friendly. It's very objective because we know the weaknesses, we suggest the improvement. This is some summary, which is, I think, this finding no longer relevant, but ni I think 2017, where we have actually some companies, ni all of these four companies are statutory bodies. So markah-markah dia kita tengok vision and goal, ada yang 62%, ada yang 73%. Remember, this instrument is not meant to compare. Tak ada intention nak compare, tapi want to see, after doing so many, we can see the trend actually. Some small companies are more ahead than the big company. I'm not surprised on that. Basically, kalau kita tengok markah-markah in Malaysia, company-company in Malaysia, at that point in time, I would say this one 2017, score dia is between 55 to 63. But of late, I think dah jumpa 78, 79. Okay, the good part about corporate integrity system just now, it equip actually, the company can use this to move forward into getting anti-bribery management system, ISO 37000. I think CIRIM has this because ARI is not a certification body. We don't actually issue ISO 37000. So normally what we do, we will advise our client pergi kat CIRIM or other private certification bodies to award the ISO 37000 with all the document lah. So apa-apa pun document is very important kan, sebab when you buat corporate integrity system for example, you have to document it. So evidence is important. So I try to map, actually it's not like this corporate integrity system ni tadi yang 14 dimension and anti-bribery management system in term of contact, leadership, support resources, competency, operation, performance evaluation and improvement. This is corporate integrity system punya dimension. On the right is ADMS punya checklist. So we map kan, memang if you have implement or if you try dah guna instrument ni, it's easier for you to apply anti-bribery management system. Okay, and also the corruption risk assessment. Okay, I think I will, I finish. Perhaps kawan-kawan Dato' Asna, if you want to add, because I have a lot of partners in this, because this project is not belong to ARI alone, but ARI is working together with IIM, Institute Integrity Malaysia. Unfortunately, I do not know whether I have friends from Integrity Malaysia. As far as I know, today, this morning, they are having discussion dengan Datuk Bandar Kelang, jadi perbandaran Kelang on integrity system, they want to implement something. So also Datuk Asna and Pronoma, I think is having class. So if you I have Afzal here with me. Afzal is my PhD. I saw apa Rajesh. Okay, Rajesh from.
Yeah, hi. Prof. Thank you so much, Prof. Could you, Prof, thank you so much. I think I should take this opportunity to thank yourself, your good self, as well as UITM for helping and assisting IIM all this while in making this instrument successful. And I think throughout the past few years, we have done for over 20 companies, including GLCs and also private sector. The tool has been very useful, and a lot of the companies has commented they'll be able to use the tool for the betterment of their organization in order to make improvement whatever the areas that they need to make improvement. And I think the tool is also will be helpful in organizations which are moving forward to do their corruption risk management, anti-bribery management as well, and it can be used as a gap analysis tool. And with the improvement of the instrument itself, yeah, Prof, which we are doing at this moment, and with your team, it will make this instrument much more capable in assessing an organization and in terms of ethics and integrity. Yeah, Prof, thank you so much.
Okay, Rajesh, thank you for your kind words. I think Rajesh is one of the anchor in IIM focusing or doing on corporate integrity. Maybe I should inform Rajesh that we secure a few projects from Kerajaan Negeri Sabah. We have to actually manage our time so that we can help more companies in Sabah. Okay, any question? Datuk want to say something, because Datuk Asna is actually she's from UMP, from USM, now moved to UMP. Now, because she was one of the founder working very hard to make sure the instrument ready to be used. It was, I think, early 2010.
Okay, terima kasih, Pak. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good morning to all of you. Saya tertarik dengan slide yang Prof tunjukkan, di mana kita ada buat, Prof ada buat summary comparison kan? Dari segi dimension mana yang kita tengok yang mungkin consistently showed that kena ada improvement. Saya tengok di sini especially on measurement, research and assessment, that's quite low, yang 40, dan juga ethics training and education. I think I must congratulate Ari for very good job right from the very beginning sampailah sekarang. Dan saya amat-amat respect lah Ari, sebab because of you and your team, maka instrumen ni berkembang dengan pesatnya. Maknanya ramai lagi yang nak masuk dan orang dah mula, orang kata percaya dan mula nak gunakan instrumen ni. Tapi mungkin kita boleh come out with now a proper recommendation, since kita dah tahu dah dia punya trend kat situ yang lacking kan. Apa secara praktikalnya yang boleh kita ajukan kepada pihak atasan, agaknya kan, policy paper tentang perkara-perkara yang rendah ni lah, especially on measurement, research and assessment dan seterusnya lah. Sebab saya rasa dari foundation tu dah mungkin dah mula ada nampak dia punya peningkatan lah, itulah. Tu Prof, saya cadangkan macam tu mungkin for future research kan.
Yeah, good idea lah if you can have like template kan, because finding almost similar. Oh, if this is the situation, this is what you have to do. It's like macam apa, standard template, so easy on our part and also on our client. I agree with you, Dato.
And you can sell that software lah kiranya kan,
if you like. Ah, buat software.
Thank you.
Good idea. Tu orang-orang IT, anybody from IT boleh bagi idea on how. In fact, dulu we started with manual ya, Prof, Dato. Manual isi satu-satu. Now imagine after we manage to get 2,000 respondent from Mara. Datuk buat Mara kan?
Ya, yes, saya.
In satu-satu pakai SPSS. Nak nangis kan zaman tu. Sekarang we don't have to do that because everything is on online.
Ya, yeah, betul.
So bayangkan perjalanan kita begitu jauh ya.
Sampai saya dah bencin lah ni.
Tapi masih diperlukan lagi. Produknya
semua kaya. Saya suka.
Yeah, getting more and more now.
Thank you.
Okay, ada soalan? Anybody yang berminat nak join in atau bantu kita improve kita punya presentation so that our report is of high class, because we are dealing with client yang top lah. Board of director. Ada soalan lain? Otherwise.
Prof, I just want to check with you, yeah, on just a comment regard to the presentation to clients, kan? Maybe we can look at improving how the presentations are done at the moment, and of course with the assistance of the dashboard, it looks clearer because you can actually cross check demographic figures to the what do you call this, to the results, right? Tapi in terms of recommendation kan, dan untuk setiap organisasi tu, kita tak boleh ada satu standard template yang mengatakan in order for you to improve this, you have to do this. It actually work tailor it to each organisation at the moment. Tapi based on our experience, we in discussion with the client, we collect the ideas on recommendation. So that's how we go about giving them recommendations, using recommendations that which has been a collective pot, which we share with others. And during the discussion with their integrity unit and all that, we get the actual recommendation they need to do for the organization based on the results. So what do you think, Prof? How we can improve on the recommendations?
Yeah, mungkin I do not know. We have to really brainstorming on this, whether we should have, but the way we present maybe so far, yeah, so far okay, but maybe perhaps if someone can give us better idea, because we are presenting the board, they are busy people, they expect high level, high tech kind of presentation. So but of course, as you say, recommendation cannot be like one recommendation fit all. It cannot be like that. It must be tailor-made with our client, different client with different size, different target, different objective missions. I think we have to bear in mind on that, so that the recommendation is going to be very much tailor-made. So Tim Sabah, any comment? Oh yeah, I just want to say something just now. Afzal, I think he is here. He did his PhD on this, and his viva is this Friday. Wish him luck.
Luck.
On integrity and integrity violation. So far, I got 2 students doing on this. Ada soalan-soalan lain?
Itulah betul juga tadi Rajesh cakap tadi, but I think mungkin the template tu could be a general one, tapi there's going to be like specific recommendation also based on the nature size of the organisation lah. But at least kalau kita tengok overall, dia macam repeat recommendation, dia sort of repeat
kan, the problem
recommendation kan yang
betul. Kita
secara am lah, but not those are the things.
Oh, then there is a question. They kata there are gap between public and private sector. Have you considered this as well? I think our last time, the original document, Corporate Integrity Ethic by Dubinsky, is meant for private sector. Yeah, then when we consider, because there is a question on this, I think, of course, some of the instrument is not suitable. That's why at that time, we replaced one dimension. It was in 2017, I think, we replaced corporate integrity CSR, corporate social responsibility with accountability. So for private sector, we have one element or one dimension, we call it corporate CSR. Then for public sector, we replace CSR, because to us, public sector, their job is to do CSR. Why must we ask question? That is a mandatory thing. So we replace that with accountability for public sector. So that is the way, I hope I'm answering your question, Shaira Ismail. Yeah, I agree with you. The instrument is meant for private sector. Original document from private, and most of our client private. But we do have actually amendment for public sector. In fact, it's not public sector, it's statutory bodies. It's also, we can consider public sector lah. For public sector, we do have a special instrument where we replace one of the dimensions, CSR, into accountability to make sure that the public sector is delivering their accountability.
Assalamualaikum, Prof. J.
Ya, ini tim Sabah yang telah secure banyak projek ni. Prof. Imbarin.
Ya, assalamualaikum semua. Prof. J, actually just to say something about the presentations last week, right? Sebenarnya, you know, like I think like I have to agree with Shaira Ismail. Dia ada question when they're asking about the employee mindset. Okay, inilah juga yang kita kena fikirkan, because one of the outcome from the meeting and from the presentation, and the top management actually a bit worry in terms of the acceptance by the employee yang especially the lower level employee lah. Jadi itu yang kena fikirkan macam mana kita nak cari the best approach nak you know like to make them involved in this what called CISM activities ni.
Okay.
Itu yang kena fikirkan.
Yeah, I like I think Shaira is asking the barrier is related to employees' mindset, especially the lower level. Changing the culture is not easy as it involves with people attitudes, behaviors and perception. What is the best change management approach to be considered? Okay, balik kat sini. This instrument is at, for organizational level kan? Whereas the problem with ethic ini involve individual. So actually, I think Rajis ada satu lagi instrument untuk individual. How to change in the individual tu tadi. Tapi kita punya ni lebih kepada
That is a psychometric test.
Individual,
individual profiling tool.
I think that is another because it is not possible for us to have instrument yang boleh cater dua-dua. Organizational and also individual. So we have separate instrument. Tapi Ari tak actively involved in the psychometric instrument yang individual tu. So Ari is focusing on the organizational level tadi. Tapi I don't blame you. Macam mana nak change the culture of individual tu. Tapi sebenarnya ramai orang kata from the top kan. If the top are serious, I think yang bawah-bawah ni lebih mudah nak handle lah. Tapi I agree with you. The instrument is not able to change the culture, the belief, the behavior of orang bawahan. Except our instrument mungkin datangnya dari atas mana we believe that kalau leadership is serious about ethic integrity, yang bawah easier tu akan follow lebih mudah. Okay ya, I leave the one study so that in case you are interested, you can get the ID. Those who are actually interested to join this project, I think we need more people, especially orang IT because yelah, apa-apa pun sekarang IT is very important. And I think on my part, I am done lah Nadia.
Kalau tak ada soalan daripada peserta, kita ada lagi ke soalan daripada peserta?
Okay, they can boleh tanya kemudian. I think okay. First, thank you to everyone. I really enjoy sharing my little experience with you all. Thanks to my team also, Rajesh from IIM. Thanks to Datuk Atna kerana sudi join group ni walaupun I bagi last minute notice pagi ni would like to join. And also my team yang ada dekat Batuk Bandar Kelang tak dapat. So I would most of all, I need to thank Prof. Norma because this is her hard work since 2010. I join in March later. I menyambung aja benda-benda yang dia dah settlekan.
Okay, terima kasih kepada yang berbahagia Profesor Dr. Jamal Said atas sesi perkongsian sebentar tadi. Baiklah, maka itu berakhirlah sesi webinar kita pada hari ini. Dengan berakhirnya sesi ini, diharapkan agar semua peserta dapat memahami segala aspek yang telah dikongsikan sebentar tadilah. Pihak Sekretariat ingin memohon maaflah sekiranya ada kekurangan sepanjang sesi ini berlangsung. Dan sebelum saya menutup majlis, mohon kerjasama dan jasa baik yang berbahagia Profesor, Tuan-Puan untuk mengisi jam latihan dan memberi maklum balas bagi program ini seperti di link yang Sekretariat ada kongsi di ruangan chat. Okay, terima kasih.
Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum.